Penguin Random House Audio present The Bounty, The True Story of the Mutiny on the Bounty by Caroline Alexander, read for you by Nicholas Boulton. To Smokey. Author's note. Every attempt has been made to use and quote from first-hand source material wherever available. In such quotations, the original and often erratic spelling, punctuation, grammar, and typographical conventions, e.g. liberal use of uppercase initial letters, have been retained. In the case of John Fryer's narrative alone, punctuation has on occasion been added for more straightforward reading. Personal names are particularly variable, and I've attempted to use the form the individual in question used where this can be ascertained, rather than to rely on bounty story conventions. In the case of the 10 mutineers brought to court-martial, this is not difficult to establish, as each of the 10 defendants left a deposition signed with his signature, thus Burkett, not Burkitt, Burn without an E, not Burn with an E, although the alternate forms occur frequently in the language of second parties. In other cases, problematic names were established by correspondence, wills, or similar personal documentation. Midshipman John Hallett's father signed his correspondence Hallett with two T's, not, as Bligh and others wrote, Hallett with one T, and so forth. There is strong evidence to suggest that Matthew Quintal, one of the mutineers, regarded himself as Matthew Quintrell. But here, deference is made to the spelling adopted by his present-day descendants. Geographical places are referred to by their names at the time, with the modern equivalent in parentheses on first mention. Kupang, Kupang. Endeavour Strait, Torres Strait. A nautical day began and ended at noon with the noon sighting, not at midnight as in civil time. Thus, the mutiny on the Bounty occurred on the morning of April the 28th, 1789, in both sea and civil time. Some 4 hours later, however, it was April the 29th by nautical reckoning. There is occasional awkwardness when the two systems collide, as when a returning ship comes into port and a running commentary begun at sea resumes on land. No attempt has been made to convert sea to civil time. Dates of events recorded at sea are given as stated in the ship's log. All mileage figures for distances at sea are given in nautical miles. A nautical mile consisted at the time of 6,116 feet, or 1 minute of latitude. A statute mile consists of 5,280 feet. All temperatures cited in the ship's log are in degrees Fahrenheit. 1 pound sterling comprised 20 shillings. A guinea equaled 1 pound plus 1 shilling. The valuation of currency of this time can be gauged by certain standard of living indicators. Fletcher Christian's mother expected to live comfortably on 40 guineas a year. A post-captain of a first-rate ship received £28 a month in pay, a lieutenant, £7, an able seaman, £1, 4 shillings, less deductions. Prelude. Spithead, winter 1787. His small vessel pitching in the squally winter sea, a young British naval lieutenant waited restlessly to embark upon the most important and daunting voyage of his still young but highly promising career. William Bligh, aged 33, had been selected by His Majesty's government to collect breadfruit plants from the South Pacific island of Tahiti and to transport them to the plantations of the West Indies. Like most of the Pacific, Tahiti, Otaheite, was little known. In all the centuries of maritime travel, fewer than a dozen European ships had anchored in her waters. Bligh himself had been on one of these early voyages 10 years previously, when he had sailed under the command of the great Captain Cook. Now he was to lead his own expedition in a single small vessel called Bounty. With his ship mustered and provisioned for 18 months, Bligh had anxiously been awaiting the Admiralty's final orders, which would allow him to sail, since his arrival at Spithead in early November. A journey of some 16,000 miles lay ahead, including a passage around Cape Horn, some of the most tempestuous sailing in the world. Any further delay, Bligh knew, would ensure that he approached the Horn at the height of its worst weather. By the time the orders arrived in late November, the weather at Spithead itself had also deteriorated to the extent that Bligh had been able to advance no farther than the Isle of Wight, from where he wrote a frustrated letter to his uncle-in-law and mentor, Duncan Campbell. If there is any punishment that ought to be inflicted on a set of men for neglect, I am sure it ought on the Admiralty, he wrote irascibly on December 10, 1787, for my 3 weeks' detention at this place during a fine fair wind which carried all outward-bound ships clear of the channel but me, who wanted it most. Nearly 2 weeks later, he had retreated back to Spithead, still riding out bad weather. It is impossible to say what may be the result, Bligh wrote to Campbell, his anxiety mounting. I shall endeavour to get round the Horn, but with heavy gales, should it be accompanied with sleet and snow, my people will not be able to stand it. Indeed, I feel my voyage a very arduous one, and have only to hope in return that whatever the event may be, my poor little family may be provided for. I have this comfort, he continued with some complacency, that my health is good, and I know of nothing that can scarce happen, but I have some resource for. My little ship is in the best of order, and my men and officers all good and feel happy under my directions. At last, on December 23, 1787, the Bounty departed England, and after a rough passage, arrived at Santa Cruz in Tenerife. Here, fresh provisions were acquired and repairs made, for the ship had been mauled by severe storms. The first sea that struck us carried away all my spare yards and some spars, Bligh reported, writing again to Campbell. The second broke the boat's chocks and stove them, and I was buried in the sea with my poor little crew. Despite the exasperating delay of his departure, the tumultuous passage, and the untold miles that still lay ahead, Bligh's spirits were now high, manifestly higher than when he had first set out. On February 17, 1788, off Tenerife, he took advantage of a passing British whaler, the Queen of London, to drop a line to Sir Joseph Banks, his patron, and the man most responsible for the breadfruit venture. I am happy and satisfied in my little ship, and we are now fit to go round half a score of worlds, Bligh wrote. Both men and officers tractable and well-disposed, and cheerfulness and content in the countenance of every one. I am sure nothing is even more conducive to health. I have no cause to inflict punishments, for I have no offenders, and everything turns out to my most sanguine expectations. My officers and young gentlemen are all tractable and well-disposed, he continued in the same vein to Campbell, and we now understand each other so well that we shall remain so the whole voyage. Bligh fully expected these to be his last communications on the outward voyage, but monstrous weather off Cape Horn surpassed even his worst expectations. After battling contrary storms and gales for a full month, he conceded defeat and reversed his course for the Cape of Good Hope. He would approach Tahiti by way of the Indian Ocean and Van Diemen's Land, now Tasmania, a detour that would add well over 10,000 miles to his original voyage. I arrived here yesterday, he wrote to Campbell on May the 25th from the southernmost tip of Africa. After experiencing the worst of weather off Cape Horn for 30 days, I thought I had seen the worst of everything that could be met with at sea, yet I have never seen such violent winds or such mountainous seas. A Dutch ship, he could not resist adding, had also arrived at the Cape with 30 men having died on board, and many more gravely ill. Bligh had brought his entire company through, safe and sound. The Bounty passed a month at the Cape recovering, and was ready to sail at the end of June. A still arduous journey lay ahead, but Bligh's confidence was now much greater than when he had embarked. Indeed, in this respect, he had shown himself to be the ideal commander, one whose courage, spirits, and enthusiasm were rallied, not daunted, by difficulties and delays. Along with his ship and men, he had weathered the worst travails he could reasonably expect to face. The long-anticipated silence followed, but when, over a year later, it was suddenly broken, Bligh's correspondence came not from the Cape, nor any other port of call on the expected route home, but from Kupang in the Dutch East Indies. The news he reported in letters to Duncan Campbell, to Joseph Banks, and above all to his wife Elizabeth, was so wholly unexpected, so unconnected to the stream of determined and complacent letters of the year before, as to be almost incomprehensible. "My dear, dear Betsy," Bligh wrote with palpable exhaustion to his wife on August 19, 1789, "I am now in a part of the world that I never expected. It is, however, a place that has afforded me relief and saved my life. Know then, my own dear Betsy, I have lost the bounty." Pandora, Tahiti, 1791. At daylight, on a fine, fair, breezy day in March, a young man in his late teens said goodbye to his wife and stepped out of his neat cottage, picturesquely set amid citrus trees at the foot of a hill, for an excursion to the mountains. Darkly tanned and heavily tattooed with the traditional patterns of manhood across his backside, the youth could have passed for one of the Tahitians who met him outside. Peter Haywood, however, was an Englishman, not an Indian, and close observation would have revealed that one of the tattoos inked on his leg was not native, but the symbol of the Isle of Man. Young Haywood had been living here in his idyllic garden home just beyond Matavai Bay since September 1789, when the bounty, under the command of master's mate, Fletcher Christian, had deposited him and 15 other shipmates at Tahiti and then vanished in the night, never to be seen again. Peter Haywood, former midshipman on the bounty, had been only a few weeks shy of 17 on the morning the mutiny had broken out and his close friend and distant relative Fletcher Christian had taken the ship. At Christian's command, Lieutenant Bligh and 18 loyalists had been compelled to go overboard into one of the bounty's small boats, where they had been left, bobbing in the wide Pacific, to certain death. Fletcher Christian's control of the mutineers was to last no more than 5 months. When he eventually directed the bounty back to Tahiti for what would be her final visit, he had done so because his company had disintegrated into factions. The majority of his people wished to bail out and take their chances at Tahiti, even though, as they knew, a British naval ship would eventually come looking for them. Some of these men had been loyal to Bligh, but had been held against their will on board the bounty. Peter Haywood had been one of the last men to take his farewell of Christian, whom he still regarded with affectionate sympathy. Then, when the bounty had departed for good, he had turned back from the beach to set about the business of building a new life. Now, on this fresh March day, a year and a half after Christian's departure, Peter was setting out for the mountains with friends. He had gone no more than 100 yards from his home when a man came hurrying after him to announce that there was a ship in sight. Running to the hill behind his house with its convenient lookout over the sea, he spotted the ship lying to only a few miles distant. Peter would later claim that he had seen this sight with the utmost joy, but it is probable that his emotions were somewhat more complicated. Racing down the hill, he went to the nearby home of his close friend, Midshipman George Stewart, with the news. By the time he and Stewart had splashed their way out to the ship, another man, Joseph Coleman, the bounty's armourer, was already on board. On introducing themselves as formerly of the bounty, Haywood and Stewart had been placed under arrest and led away for confinement. The ship Pandora had been specifically commissioned to apprehend the mutineers and bring them to justice in England. These morning hours of March the 23rd, 1791, were the last Peter Haywood would spend on Tahiti. The news of the mutiny on board His Majesty's armed vessel Bounty had reached England almost exactly a year before. How the news arrived was even more extraordinary than the mutiny, for the messenger had been none other than Lieutenant William Bligh himself. After Fletcher Christian had put him and the Loyalists into the Bounty's launch off the island of Tofua, Bligh, against all imaginable odds, had navigated the little 23-foot-long craft 3,618 miles over a period of 48 days to Timor in the Dutch East Indies. Here, his starving and distressed company had been humane.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.